Hello class 6. So today we are going to discuss the chapter number 9, the Mauryan Empire, and this is the part 1 series of the video. So the Mauryan Empire or the mighty Mauryans. There is a new era which began in the history of India with the establishment of the powerful Mauryan Empire in the region of Magadha, whose capital is Pataliputra, and later it spread to the various other parts of India as well as outside India as well. And the Mauryan rulers, they played a great role in the spread of Jainism and Buddhism. So we will read about the two great rulers of this empire, the Chandragupta Maurya founder as well as Ashoka, who had spread this empire outside India also. So first of all, we'll see the dynasty tree of the Magadha. So Magadha has been an important place or important Mahajanpadas among the all 16 Mahajanpadas. The reason was that the Magadha, it was basically, lying to the region which is very fertile, which is Ganga Yamuna Doab area, which is the most fertile area. It is having a great iron deposit, which is most useful at the time for the agriculture and the war purposes. They are having an immense amount of the wealth. Taxes were collected in a very big way. So they are having a great source of income as well as the different sources, natural sources and the human sources. Now we see the dynasty tree of Magadha. Magadha was basically established, or we can say the first ruler of Magadha was Bimbisara. He was succeeded by his son Ajatashatru, and after that Ajatashatru, there was new empire which came into form, that is Nanda Empire. It was led by Mahapadmanand. So Mahapadmanand, he was the founder of Nanda Empire. His son Dhananand succeeded him, and after Dhananand, Chandragupta Maurya, he led the foundation of Mauryan Empire with his tutor, or we can say with his guru, that is Chanakya. So with Chanakya, he laid the foundation of the Mauryan Empire. He was succeeded by his son Bindusara, then Ashoka, who is regarded as Ashoka the Great, and then Brihadrath, he was the last ruler of Mauryan Empire. So Brihadrath was being killed or assassinated by his own commander-in-chief of military, Pushyamitra Shung, who laid the foundation of the Shunga dynasty. So this is the dynasty tree of the Magadha, and in this chapter we will read about the Mauryan Empire, specifically about the Chandragupta Maurya and Ashoka and their empire. So if we will see the literary sources, first of all, that from where we get to know about the Maurya. So first important source is Indica. So Indica is a book. It was written by Megat Smith. He is a great ambassador in the court of Chandragupta Maurya to Pataliputra. That is basically the capital of the Maurya. So he was a Greek ambassador. After the invasion of the Alexander the Great, the Greeks, they had established a friendly relations with the Mauryans, and they had a contact with the court of the great emperors. So Megasthenes, he was basically the ambassador in the court of Chandragupta Maurya at Pataliputra. His book, which he is written by the name of Indica, it throws light or give account of the political, socio-economic conditions of the period of the empire at the time. So that how the people are living, how the society was, what is the economic condition, how the politically well established that region is. So the political knowledge about the Mauryas, the social knowledge, economic knowledge about the Mauryas, we get to know from the book Indica. The second important book is Arthashastra. It was written by Chanakya, who was the mentor of Chandragupta Maurya. He also have two other names. He is also regarded as Vishnugupta and Kautilya. So famously, people call him Chanakya. He was basically a teacher in the Takshila University, which was one of the learning center at the time. And then he saw Chandragupta Maurya and he mentored him. He made the Empire of United India under the Mauryan Empire. His book Arthashastra, it threw light on the Mauryan administration basically. It also gave a guideline to the kings that how they should administer their territories. So Arthashastra basically it threw light on the administration. It has given the duties of the king, the duties of the people, the duty of different departments of the government. The rulers of Magadha, basically the Nanda has become very popular among the common people. So Nandas, they were basically what happened, they are exploiting people, and because of that the people also don't want him to be the king. So at the same time, Chandragupta Maurya, he de-established the modern Nanda dynasty and established his own empire. So these are the two sources through which we get to know about Maurya. Now you can see here, this is Chandragupta Maurya and his mentor Chanakya. These two figures are Chandragupta Maurya and Chanakya. We will read about Chandragupta Maurya first. So Chandragupta Maurya, he overthrew the Dhananand, the last ruler of the mighty Nandas. The Nandas are very rich and they are very enriched one. But what happened, because Dhananand, he was very much cruel ruler, he was very much included into his pleasure taking works, and he is not worried about any of his subjects. He brutally collect the taxes, so people were also don't like him. And Chandragupta Maurya has saw this opportunity and he overthrew Dhananand, and with the help of his chief Chanakya, he established his empire. After ascending the throne, Chandragupta Maurya, he captured the West Punjab and Sindh area, because when he captured the throne, it was only Magath was that was under his hand or that was under his power, but later he extended his empire. He has captured the west of the Punjab and the Sindh area. He further extended his territories by defeating Seleucus Nicator, who was a Greek king, west of the Indus, and gained territories of Herat, Kandahar and Kabul. He was the founder of the Mauryan Empire, and his empire extended up to Mysore in the south and Kabul in the northwest, Saurashtra in the west and Bengal in the east. So this is the extent of the empire of Chandragupta Maurya. So he has been literally regarded as the founder of the Mauryan Empire. Chandragupta Maurya, in the later years of his life, he accepted Jainism, he gave up his throne, and then he went to the South India, and after that his son Bindusara, he became the next. Okay, yes. Now Chandragupta Maurya empire, you can see here, this is the empire map of Chandragupta Maurya. So it was only Pataliputra, when he became the king, it was only Pataliputra that was under his hand, but later he extended it to east as well as the western part of the country. So this is the empire map of Chandragupta Maurya empire. We are not going to read about Bindusara, we will directly going to Ashoka. Now Ashoka, after the name of Ashoka, the Ashoka the Great also comes. Now we will read why he called Ashoka the Great. So you can see here, his empire, he extended in south, his grandfather is already extended in the northwestern frontier, but he is the only person who extended till the southern India, and also he extended his empire outside India also. So his empire was far bigger as comparison to the other rulers, and there were many reforms which he did. That's why he is regarded as Ashoka the Great, that we will read in the next slide. Yes, Ashoka. So Ashoka was the third and the most enlightened king of the Mauryan dynasty. Like if anybody says if you know any one ruler about the Maurya, so everybody will speak about Ashoka. So he was one of the most enlightened king of Mauryan dynasty. Now we will read, as a prince, he was appointed as a governor of Ujjain. Like Bindusara, he has many sons, and every prince has been appointed as a governor first of all of any of the territory, so that they can gain the experience of dealing with people and the administration, and then they were promoted as king. So he was appointed as a governor of Ujjain, and for becoming king he killed his 99 brothers. So he was very violent at the time. He has 99 brothers and he killed all of them to become the king, and because they were his competitors, he was very violent king. Kalinga, Odisha. Kalinga was basically the ancient name of Odisha. There was a Kalinga war which played a very important role in the life of Ashoka. Like nearly 1 lakh, when Ashoka has mostly a Mauryan empire, it has captured almost all the part of the India except Kalinga. Like except the area of Kalinga, it was not been part of the Mauryan empire. So Ashoka has attracted towards this area and he wanted to capture it. So he had a war with the Kalinga ruler that was famously known as Kalinga war. It played a very important role in the life of Ashoka because nearly 1 lakh people were being killed. So when Ashoka saw the grief taken, like after the war was over, he went to the battleground and he saw that every woman is crying, their children were crying, because many people, they were grief stricken, many people were killed and there was been funeral fire. So his heart was filled with sorrow and misery, and he thinks that I am the only person responsible for all these misery, for all these cry and things and grief. So he was totally shattered. So at that time, one of the Buddhist monk, he came to him and he asked him that if you want to do any type of penance, if you want to do a kind of pashchatap, we can say, so you can do that. So he adopted Buddhism and he left the path of war, he left the path of the violence, and he became totally a non-violent ruler. And it was not only that he said, okay, I'm a non-violent ruler now. No, after that he has not led any of the wars. Okay. So this Kalinga war incident plays a very important role in the Ashoka life, because it turned a violent ruler to be a non-violent ruler, and not only he accepted Buddhism, he also spread the teachings of Buddhism. He has never forced on his people to accept the Buddhism, but he wants his people to accept the moral duty. Kalinga war turned Ashoka from a violent king to a non-violent king. He inscribed his peaceful thoughts, which were known as Dhamma. So he made few points which he think that every person should follow and which he himself follow, that he called Dhamma. Dhamma means, Dhamma is a Prakrit word, while in Hindi or Sanskrit it is Dharma. So Dharma means, which is your duty, that you as a human being, it is your duty to perform that. So he has inscribed the teachings of the Dhamma or Dharma in the rocks, into the various rocks of his empire, into various pillars of his empire, so that people, when they are going from here and there, they can just read it and they can, you know, apply that into their life. And also appointed officers, which is known as Dhamma Mahamatas, to go to different places to spread the messages, to check the people are performing their duties or not all over his empire. After the war, Digvijay. Like before war, Digvijay, a policy of conquest was been there. Like he just want to conquer every part of the country by his sword. But later, when he after the Kalinga war, when he accepted Buddhism, when he embraced Buddhism, his policy of conquest or Digvijay converted into Dharma Vijay or Dhamma Ghosha, which means victory of Dharma. Now he don't want to, you know, extend his empire on the basis of his sword, on the basis of war. He just want to spread his empire on the basis of the activities or the policies of the Dharma or by the activity of love. So this war has totally turned him to be a peaceful ruler, and he spread his empire, he spread Buddhism as well. That's why Ashoka has been regarded as Ashoka the Great. Yes. Now Ashoka Empire, you can see here, you have seen about the map of Chandragupta Maurya Empire. So that was only been extended till the northern part and the part of the west, while Ashoka, he spread to the southern part as well. He spread his empire in Sri Lanka and the outer world also. So Ashoka has further extended his empire after Kalinga war on the basis of his policy of Dhamma. Yes, now the Ashoka pillar edict. So this is a picture of Ashoka, and this is the pillar edict. Like in different pillars of his empire at various parts, he used to inscribe the writings of Dhamma, teachings of Dhamma into Prakrit or Pali language, which people could understand in a simple language, and people, whenever they are going one place to another place, they just read it. So this is also a good source of information to the people as well as us to know that what Ashoka has written into it. Now we will read about what are the teachings of Dhamma. So if you talk about Dhamma, the Kalinga war changed the mindset of Ashoka. Like earlier he just think that only war can, you know, conquer the people. But after the Kalinga war, his mindset has changed, and he thought that he accepted the Buddhism, his thought has also changed, and he gave the teaching of Dhamma. So the Prakrit Dhamma and the Sanskrit Dharma hold same meaning, but it has not to do with the religion. Like today, if anybody asks anyone that what is Dharma, so everybody said, yeah, I am Hindu, I am Muslim. But Dharma word is never been a part of religion. It was part of the duty, that what duty a person has to perform. It implies concepts such as justice, virtue, morality, law and duty. So these are basically the concept of Dhamma, that if you have to live a life, the basic principles of Ashoka Dhammas you have to follow, that is purity of domestic life and truthfulness. That means whatever domestic life you are living as a domestic person or a student, any kind of profession you are having, you should be truthful towards yourself and others as well. Second, toleration, that is not to speak evil of other religious faith. You should be tolerant towards other people. It was like if you are following some kind of ritual, you will not compensate or not compulse it to the other person, or you will not insult other person. You should be tolerant that if you are respecting yours, you should respect others also. Ahimsa, that means non-violence. You will not do violence to any person. And true ceremonial, that means you have to perform all the duty in a better way. You have to respect for your parents and elders, and kindness towards the slaves and the servants. You should give charity for the poor. So these are basically the principles, we can say the moral principles of the Ashoka's Dhamma. Ashoka inscribed his Dhamma's teachings in the rock pillars all over his empire, were mainly written in Brahmi script. He appointed the special officers to spread the teachings of Mahamatras to propagate Dharma. Ashoka built hospitals for both men and animals. So he became so, we can say, humble. He became so liberal to the people. He also built the rest houses constructed for the travelers, for the benefit of travelers. He built the good roads and also planted the shady trees onto both sides of the road, so that it will be easy for the travelers to travel and trade would be possible. So these are the things, or these are the techniques adopted by the Ashoka after he adopted. Buddhism. Now, importance of Ashoka edicts. Edicts are commands or the instructions. Edicts are basically the commands of the ruler. So these are the commands or instructions given by the ruler. So Ashoka edicts inscribed on the pillars and rocks give information about the extent of his empire. Like we have found his pillar in the southern India, so we get to know that yes, Ashoka empire is extended till here. We have a Ashokan edict or Ashoka pillar inscribed on a rock in Kalsi. So we get to know that in Uttarakhand also Ashoka extended his empire. So his pillars which we found in different parts tell us about the extent of the empire of the Ashoka. Some of his famous edicts are found at Sarnath pillar. The script of the edicts could not be deciphered for so many centuries, but it was only in the 19th century that there was a British archaeologist, that is James Prinsep, who deciphered the script, Brahmi script, and after that we get to know what was written in the pillars of Ashoka. And we get a lot of valuable information about the rule of Ashoka as well as of Maurya. Yes, so we will see here, this is the Ashoka pillar, which is at Vaishali. This is such a beautiful pillar. There is a loan at the top of it. And this is Sarnath pillar, loan capital. So this is also adopted as a national emblem by us. So I hope you understand the first part of the chapter. And in the next part, we will later discuss about the spread of the Buddhism during the Ashoka reign and also the modern art, as well as the decline of the modern art.